Good afternoon, everyone. Seems like we have a big crowd. Verena has a lot of followers. That's good. I'm Pavlos Protopapas. I am the Scientific Program Director for the Institute for Applied Computational Science. We're an institute who does computational science, as the name suggests, but a lot of data science as well. This is the last talk of spring series, and Verena is the top of our speakers. I will introduce her in a second. There's no other talks after this. The summer is free, but we'll be back early September with more talks. You check on our website for the schedule. My pleasure, of course, to introduce Verena. Verena and I have been working together for 2 years now, teaching together, discussing topics together, and we never got into a single fight, which is great. We never got into disagreement even about the lecture, so that's very good. My first challenge is to be able to say her last name, so I'm going to try. Her first name, I think I got it right, is Verena. Kaynig Fitkow.
Yes.
Good. So Verena got her first degree, diploma, bachelor, master equivalent from Hamburg in machine learning. And then she did her PhD at ETH in Zurich in machine learning PhD. Moved to Cambridge here working with Hans Peter's group. Her research interest is in machine learning, in applied in computer vision, and especially in medical imaging, even though the things they're imaging are dead way before they imaging them, but nevertheless. She's working at the Connectomics project, and today she's going to be describing all the work, the amazing work they've done for that project. Thank you.
Thank you. So let me actually go back. I just thought that was a nice little picture to look at. Thanks, Pavlos, for the introduction. Thanks for having me. So Connectomics is about mapping the brain. And as Pavlos already said, there is no way I could have done this by myself. So this is a collaborative effort. It's actually between Jeff Lichtman's group, which is located in the Northwest building over there, and Hans Peter's group. The computer science people typically also live in the Northwest building now because it makes discussing things with the biologists a lot easier. But in principle, Hans Peter's group is located actually in this building upstairs. So Bobby Kasturi did a lot of the data that I'm going to show here. Josh Morgan, Alyssa, also are biologists who do connectomics. Richard is the electron microscopy guy who's sitting in the basement day and almost every night to make the microscopes running. Dongil Lee did a lot of the annotations. And Daniel Berger, according to Jeff, is the fastest and best annotator in the world. And he also does software development for manual annotation. And then on Hans Peter's side, there's Ray Thewis Jones, which I think a lot of people here know because he taught the high performance computing class. So he's, when he's not teaching, he's doing research in connectomics. Then Adi, who's actually here, does a lot of the alignment work. Daniel Han is a PhD student in the group who works on proofreading. And then these guys, unfortunately, by now left the group, but their spirits live on in our pipeline. So Seymour did a lot of the number crunching. The results I'm going to show in the end actually were produced by him. So he basically took the whole pipeline, did a lot of software engineering, and made it work. And then Amelia and Bjorn did methods development that we are still using. And I actually realized there's one name missing here. Felix just wrote a master thesis with me and is going to join Hans Peter's lab as a PhD student after the summer. So I'm very excited about that part. And Lee is going to help with the software development and hopefully outperform Seymour, which is going to be very hard, but he's looking promising. So you already stared at this picture for a while now. When I saw this the first time, I actually was speechless, breathless. I was like, because what, I mean, for me, this is stunningly beautiful. But what is the real amazing part is these are real reconstructions of neurons. Like typically, when you, like we've all seen this, right? TV show, some history channel, bio something. They show these cool 3D animations of neurons, right? And the camera is flying through, and you see single neurons, and there are flashes where the synapses are supposed to fire. And there's a lot of space between those neurons, typically, because they need room to navigate their camera, right? So that is all made up. That is fantasy. That is textbook. This is the real deal. This was electron microscopy data, and this was actually manually reconstructed by Bobby and Daniel. They sat down for over 2 years. Bobby was always joking that he leaves the house in the morning, and his three-year-old son does the same, and they spent the day doing the same stuff. The only difference is he has a postdoc. Because you actually needed, at that point, to manually paint in the neuron in every section, over hundreds and thousands of sections, to build these 3D reconstructions. And what looks so innocent here are three dendrites. Here, actually four, the yellow one is one as well. And you can see all these little guys here poking out. We'll talk more about them in the end, because they're making my life very hard. These are little spine necks. So these are dendrites, little spines with like spine heads on top of them. This is where the synapses are, typically. This is where the neuron gathers all its information. And all these gray guys here are axons forming connections with those dendrites. And you can already see there is not much space here in between. It's like this densely packed neurotissue, and all these cells are in there. So, and the other thing that took my breath away, like, I think it's hard to appreciate this, but I can tell you there are about 5 labs in the whole world that could produce such a picture. Because you need immense effort on the electron microscopy side, on the sample preparation side, and then on the reconstruction side. So connectomics is a growing field, but at this large scale, it's still pretty rare. So this is the textbook neuron. Right? When we were in school, this is what we learned. Like, and you can already see all those little spines here are missing. So it's a simplified version. But you have the soma here, and you have the dendrites collecting all the signal. And then you have the axon going out, right? And then also branching in the end, and then giving connections to other dendritic trees of other neurons. So we are interested in the connectivity. So first of all, in the 3D reconstruction of these neurons and their anatomy, and then in the connections between the neurons, in the hope that by gathering this connectivity, we can get insight into the functional structure of the brain. Like, how does it actually work? And this actually goes all the way back to Raymond Cajal, who's kind of the father of neuroanatomy. So in the beginning, 1900s, he did these light microscopy studies. You can see already then he was interested in how neurons are wired. So he reconstructed here in light microscopy at that point. And these are actual paintings that he did. And he has neurons, and he's trying to draw the connections to other neurons and in which direction the signal travels. So the problem is, when you are at the light microscopy level, you see whole neurons very easily. But you're limited by the fraction of light. And that is about 200 nanometers per pixel. It's about as small as you can get. Now, we are imaging at 6 nanometers per pixel because we actually need to see the synapses. So in order to do that, you need this high resolution. For that, you need electron microscopy. But here you can already see these are whole columns of brain tissue. And you see neuron types actually change, and there are some that branch like crazy. There are others, and here you can very nicely see that these axons can travel for very long distances. That means for our algorithms that they need to be able to trace automatically thin axons through very large, long distances. Very long means micrometers, sometimes up to millimeters here. It's still, when you're imaging at the nanometer range, that's quite an amount of pixels to follow through, and you're not allowed to make a mistake, because otherwise you're losing that wire, that connection. So what shocked me when I started working with Jeff was how little we actually know about the brain, right? You go to school, you learn the anatomy, you learn, well, this is somehow how we think, and this is how it stops, right? In the real neuroanatomy world, it's not clear what makes a strong connection between two neurons. Is it the number of synapses? Is it the number of vesicles they release when they fire? They actually don't know. There's no way to quantify a strong or a weak connection. We don't even really know how we learn. Do we add connections? Do we reduce synapses? And the other very big motivation for us is there are abnormalities in the brain that lead to epilepsy and things like autism that at the moment we can't anatomically pin down. I can't tell you, well, if you have autism, your synapses are reduced by this, like you have less vesicles in your synapses, something like this. So also by doing these large-scale automatic reconstructions, we're hoping to have a medical contribution and a biological contribution. Medical in helping with these diseases, biological in hopefully figuring more out about how the brain works. So why don't we know this? Because you need this very, very large reconstructions at this very, very fine level. So you're going to see later in the talk, I'm seriously talking big data here. I'm talking petabyte range and larger. Okay. So one brain would have about 100 billion neurons with about 10,000 connections per neuron. That's 10,000 connections per neuron that I will need to find at some point. These axons, I already said, can trace for millimeters, and you shouldn't make a mistake and not be able to connect those. And at the same time, then, the diameter of a cell body is actually fairly large. It's 20 microns. When I first came here, we were totally excited about a volume that was 30 by 30 by 30 microns. And when we first crunched that, we were so proud. That was like the biggest thing at that point, I actually believe, in the world that anybody attempted. And there was one cell body in there. One, yeah, right? So once we saw the reconstruction, I actually was fairly disappointed. And the biologist was like, I knew that. So this is a movie that shows you just about the scale. So in the background, where's my pointer? In the background, you have the original electron microscopy image, and it's actually very zoomed out. These brighter regions here are cell bodies. So these are about 20 microns here in diameter. And here you can see some that have been manually reconstructed, and you see these very long dendritic arbors tracing through the volume. And this was made by Daniel Berger. He's also very good at 3D renderings. So this, again, is the real deal. These are actual real neurons that I'm showing. And we call it the red dendrite because this is the largest annotated data set we have. But what you can actually see really densely annotated is just this tiny cylinder around it. That took over a year in manual effort. So in principle, I said 100 billions of neurons. In principle, we would want to do the whole brain, right? So that is our goal. Nah, not really. We can't do that. We can't. Not at the moment, maybe in 10 years. So what we're actually doing is mini connectomics. And we're going in the short term, and the short term, I think, is the next 5 years. We're actually attempting to do one cortical column, which is about 1 cubic millimeter. That's the size of a grain of salt, okay? It's teeny, teeny, tiny. But for us, that is over a petabyte of data, okay? Not gigabyte, not terabyte, petabyte. So this is how it works. This is a mouse brain. So in Jeff Lichtman's lab, they actually do mammalian tissue. There are other labs, I said there are about 5, certainly under 10 labs in the world that do connectomics. A lot of them actually are interested in other organisms like flies, fruit flies, a big thing in Janelia. And then even nematodes and the C. elegans worm. So they go for smaller organisms because they think that cubic millimeter is crazy. if we do the cubic millimeter, we can do a whole fruit fly brain easily because it's actually smaller. But we are going for the mammalian part. So you need to take a piece of tissue out. So this is then cut into 30 nanometer sections. The electron microscope is a scanning electron microscope. It doesn't really work like a light microscope. Instead, the electrons are reflected and then collected, right? In your light microscope, the electrons penetrate through. You still need to cut these sections because you can only image a certain depth, right? So you can image up to a certain depth, and then you need to cut, and you can go again, okay? You're basically scanning the surface of your section. You cut, you're scanning the next surface, you cut. So when I say cut, I mean 30 nanometer sections. So they are fairly thin. And then they are imaged in an electron microscope. Now, unfortunately, we need to cut them. We need to cut the tissue to image it. But that means we need to align the images after they come from the microscope, right? Because they're all over the place. So there's the alignment and registration. Then we have to take that whole petabyte of gray value volume and actually do the segmentation, which means identify cell boundaries, identify the 3D objects of the neurons, and identify the synapses connecting them, and possibly even do something like even count vesicles, or at least give some form of synaptic strength based on the vesicles. So this is then visualized. That is actually hard for a cubic millimeter. You've already seen with only three dendrites and all these axons, you could hardly see anything in a 3D rendering, right? If I would have asked you, is this gray guy connected to the red guy? Can't answer. So Hans-Peter actually also has two people working on visualizations that simplify this to kind of subway maps where you can see connections between different brains. And they're building 2D maps of this. So this is a research area on its own. And then unfortunately, at the moment, we still have proofreading in there. We have to because the automatic reconstruction still makes mistakes. But the biologists don't want that, right? They don't want to infer from wrong connections, wrong principles. So at the moment, humans still have to go in there then and proofread the segmentation. But then you can do the actual analysis of the connectomes. So just to give you an idea, like I'm always blown away by the scale that this works on. Is this not working anymore? No, okay. So you have your little piece of tissue, and it's embedded in plastic. And that enables it to be cut. And for me as the computer scientist, it's actually important to understand these parts, because that cutting, it's 30 nanometer section, right? Plastic is fairly sturdy, but now I'm cutting 30 nanometer sections. It's almost on that scale like if you cut bread. What happens when you cut bread is it deforms. Right? It gets squished. Even if you're using a fairly sharp knife, this is a diamond cutting this, you do have distortions. That is one of the reasons afterwards when I talk about the alignment, I'm going to tell you that it's an elastic alignment. And one of the reasons is that we need to correct for these distortions that come from the cutting and also from this part. So this is how the actual cutting then works. On the right side, there is this arm holding that little plastic thing. And then this blue guy has the knife, and it's going up and down, really like a bread slicing machine that goes back and forth, right? This one is going up and down. And then the section is sliding down the knife and into this water basin there. And that, for me, is the next part where distortions get induced. Because at 30 nanometers, that surface tension of the water actually can make a difference. So, and this is just nice to see now. I think that is funny because the sections actually form a kind of tape because capillary things at that level somehow work, and it's almost as if they're glued together. And then this was one of the big breakthroughs. So all what I've shown so far used to be done by hand manually. The poor biologists actually had to think in the morning if they can afford to drink a coffee. Because if your hand shakes too much, you can't do the work of the day, right? 30 nanometer sections. So Jeff enabled all the people in his lab to be able to drink coffee by automating this and having a robot do it. So this is called the Atom. And you can see it's the same knife mechanism. Like the blue, you can see the holder, right, and the blue cutting mechanism. And then all the thing around it is actually a tape. You have a tape that goes through and that collects all the section. And afterwards, they're automatically on a nice piece of tape. And then the biologists have to cut this tape again by hand, unfortunately, and mount it on such a wafer. So now you have all your sections there neatly, one after the other. So for us, again, there's something here that we can use, which is nice. This process keeps them fairly aligned, right? They're not crazy rotated here. So we're going to exploit that. That is nice. The problem is they are rotated. And when you look at that at the nanometer scale, there's still a significant alignment problem here that you need to solve. So anyways, these wafers are then stored and imaged in the microscope. And this is one big, big benefit that the Harvard lab has over the others. A lot of the other labs use different microscopy techniques, and those can image and have not that much of an alignment problem because they put the whole block in the microscope. They image the surface, scrape something off. Image the surface, scrape something off. They just destroyed their sample. That scrape off thing is not a section they can collect. That's gone. So when they make a mistake, they don't have an alignment problem. But when they make a mistake during the imaging, there is no going back. We decided to solve the alignment problem, and we have the big benefit we can go back and re-image. So then, that automatic cutting was not enough. So imaging still was very slow with one microscope. So Jeff teamed up with Zeiss, which is a German manufacturer for electron microscopes, and they built 61 microscopes into one. And I just saw a talk by a guy from Zeiss who said they can easily make that 200, 500, it's just a matter of money. And I was like, oh no, because you're going to see those 61 beams already are a serious challenge for us. So you have 61 beams scanning in parallel now. That's serious high throughput that we have to deal with. And the output you can see there on the left, what looks like a pixel there, is actually a 3,000 by 3,000 pixel image. That's already far larger than the typical CVPR publication deals with, one of these tiles. I get 61 of those at once, right? When this microscope takes one image, it's 61 of those. And they have this hexagonal structure. So just for us, as the computer scientists, 61 beams, each beam is imaging 3K by 3K. So every 2 to 3 seconds, that is the goal they're going for. Fortunately, it's not that fast at the moment. But they're aiming for 200 to 300 megapixels per second. That's 12 gigabytes per minute. Like when this whole big data thing came up, we started writing grants. We were excited, right? We were like, yes, please, somebody who cares about our problems. And we honestly got answers back, well, we meant big data, but not that big. So high throughput and big data to deal with. And so you get these, we call them MFOFs. These are these multi-view things where the 61 tiles are stitched together. And your first alignment problem is actually to put these in a 2D image plane all together, right? You have the microscope scanning, and then you need to put these tiles together. That's a fairly nice and easy problem because it's the same signal that was imaged, right? It's the same section. When you go from one section to the next, the signal has changed because you're 30 nanometers deeper into the tissue. The stitching in 2D was the same underlying section. So when you have overlap, and this is what we're using to solve this problem, right, you have a signal that should be the same and that you can match. So this is what such an image looks like. You can see those. I wish my, I have a stick. Yes, nice. These guys here are the vesicles I keep talking about for the synapses. Up there is actually one. So you see the vesicles on one side. Here's the postsynaptic density, I hope. And then here's the postsynaptic site. So when this synapse decides to fire, those vesicles go over, dock onto this part, and release the neurotransmitters. And what else do we have? Mitochondria here, they're like the power plants, right, of the cells. And up there, the big black outline, that's a myelinated axon. So those have a kind of insulation sheath around them so they can travel longer distances. That's very nice because it makes them easier to segment for us. So here's another example of a synapse. Very, very clear textbook example. Interesting part here, it's actually hard in the synapse detection because it's easy to make this two. You see one black smeared area here and one up there. But it's only one in 3D. It's one synapse connecting one pre and one postsynaptic site, right? Has this structure merging in the upper sections. So I went through this for one thing because I think I still think it's fun. The other part is I wanted to drive home that we're doing more than just computer vision, which is already hard. We have some additional challenges we need to face that the typical computer vision person doesn't deal with. And I think that makes the problem even more interesting. So we have to deal with these big data challenges and the high throughput of the microscope. And on the other hand, we have to keep the accuracy up, right? If you just ask me for a fast method, you can have that. But it's going to be crappy, okay? So a very accurate method is way, way harder. But the methods typically people develop now are way too slow. So our big challenge is to sometimes just take a state-of-the-art method and try to make it so fast that we can actually use it. Oops. So also some things I never ever thought about doing my PhD when I still had small data sets. So you have the 61 beam microscope. It looks a bit like a refrigerator. That thing upstairs there up in the upper left corner, that's what's giving me so much trouble. That's the 61 beam microscope. And it's actually in the basement of Northwest. And that's part of Odyssey, the big Harvard cluster, and it's in the Holyoke Center. All of a sudden, you have 200 to 300 megapixels per second to transfer over one cable. And you realize this is going to be hard. You don't get permission to dig through Harvard Yard and put a second cable down there. So we're doing something that as a computer vision person, I never dreamt of doing. We're using JPEG compression, JPEG 2000, and reducing it to 10% of the size. And it actually turned out we're using, no big surprise, convolutional neural networks for our image processing part. And the alignment uses SIFT features. And both were very robust against the artifacts introduced by that compression. So these are the things that to me still are mind-blowing, like I'm using JPEG compressed images. But so let's talk about the alignment methods. I said already we need to solve the 2D stitching, right? That is one part, and you need to do the 3D alignment. And affine transformations actually are not enough in 3D to account for these distortions that we had with the cutting and the surface tension of the water. So there are basically two big ways that are used in computer science to solve registration problems. One is to look for alignments that make the images very similar and look at the actual gray value image. That's like you want to register two faces from two photographs, right? You take a picture of yourself every day in the mirror. You want to align them to see how your face changes, right? So then you could go and say, these are the eyes here and in that picture, nose in this and in this picture. So you're providing landmarks that correspond to each other. These features have been around since 1999 and are widely used.
Forgive me, it's mighty died.
What?
I know everybody here can hear you, but I'm on. Sorry. Forgive me.
Wait, okay. Oh yeah, I'm not enough.
out a way to do these landmarks automatically. What they do is they look at the gradient of the image, and they build histograms of gradients in a certain region. And this is what you see in the middle there. See the arrows pointing out? This is just a histogram over how many pixels in that bigger area actually have that direction in their gradient. So they do that on multiple scales. SIFT stands for Scale Invariant Feature Transform. The scale invariance comes from just downsampling the image and doing the same thing again. The nice thing is they're also rotation invariant because they align this first to the majority direction of the gradient in that image patch. And that makes them ideal for image alignment, right? We have rotations in there. We have translations. Okay, the translations are not going to bother here. But that is rotation invariant is very, very nice for alignment problems. So we're using these. And then Stefan Saalfeld developed an alignment method specifically for electron microscopy images. And the way it works is you can see the correspondences here, like all those lines are correspondences from the ZIF features. And this is a mesh grid. I'm going to talk a bit more about this. So the problem is that you're facing when you do elastic alignment is that you can warp an image completely from one into the other. I always say you can warp Madonna into Michael Jackson. We've all seen that on TV, right? If I do that with a neuron, and that original neuron looked like this, and I sliced it, and now I'm perfectly aligning all those images, what I get is this. That's not what I want. The biologist is not going to like that, because I just destroyed the anatomy of the neuron, right? So you need to have some regularization there that keeps your alignment from producing the straight cylinder. So what the assumption behind this is, during the cutting, yes, it's kind of the same direction, unfortunately, right? The knife always has the same direction. I couldn't persuade the biologist yet to actually rotate the block. But it's still with the surface tension and things, you can hope that some of these distortions are independent from one section to the next. Whereas this anatomy distortion between one section to the next is going to be smooth, right? The neuron doesn't ziggy-zaggy one thing out and then goes back. So you want to align the two images and make them similar, but you want to use the least amount of transformation possible. And Stefan modeled this with a mesh spring, with a spring mesh. Basically, you have all these springs between your landmarks, right? And now, because these springs are there, if I'm trying to distort the image and move one landmark to a different location, which is what I'm doing when I do warping, right? Saying this pixel needs to go higher up, then I'm stretching that spring, and the spring doesn't like it, right? We've all pulled the spring apart. So that's the regularization there that is going to try to keep the transformation in the smallest amount possible. And he actually solves a global problem with that. And he does very cool videos. So here, this is a video of all the slices arranging themselves based on the correspondences found with the ZIF features. So he put them all on top of each other and just started solving his optimization problem. And this is what he gets out. So, and we based our method on this, but we can't do the whole global thing because his method already breaks down at 10 terabytes, I think. So we want to do a petabyte, right? So we changed it a bit. First, we're separating 2D stitching and the 3D pre-alignment. So 2D stitching, I already said, you have the image overlap, you have the same underlying signal, nice and easy. You get the correspondences, just need to filter the outliers, and you get fairly good stitching. So this is an example, like on the right, you can see maybe the white seam there. That is where the two tiles are. But actually, all the structures here go nicely through. So then for the 3D alignment, you need a 3D pre-alignment. This is now a big, big section.
this section here, each of these guys, remember, 61 images, 3K by 3K, one of these sections has 35 gigabytes. So you look at the region in the middle first, and you try to find a rough pre-alignment by looking in the middle of the other section. What is this clicker doing? Not working. Like that, and once you found a match, you have a pre-idea of how these two should be aligned. So then when you have to align the next MFOF, you can look for the same region, like you can apply the same transformation and project it onto the other section. And then you use that as the focus point of your search. What's happening? And again, you go outwards, outwards, outwards until you find your match. So instead of matching the whole image at once, we do it region by region to deal with this enormous data size. I only clicked once, I swear. Okay, not working. So, and then I already talked about the grid. And here's an example now. So on the left side, that is so zoomed out that basically this whole picture is about one pixel in the left guy, right? It's like this tiny bit. And still you can see it's very well aligned after you solve the spring mesh problem. So this is already the elastic alignment. And because the data is so large, typically we don't even render the solution. We store the tiles and we store configuration files. So the good news is we have something that works. We have something that is enabling us to do petabytes. It's just way too slow at the moment still. At the moment, this needs about a day for 10 terabytes. But it's also nowhere near finished being optimized. ID is working really hard on this. And we still have bottlenecks like those SIF features are being written to disk. And it's actually file I/O that becomes a limiting factor here. So there are still a lot of things we can do. And we're actually hoping that this can scale to the microscope. So now about the segmentation part. So that tiny cylinder got a little bit expanded there. You can see it has a second dendrite there that also got a region around it that got segmented. So that is 2 years of Daniel and Bobby's life. But already in that is actually valuable information for the biologist. So he was very happy, I mean, to render this video just to show off, but you're going to see in the end he's actually separating this into the different types, like LIA, dendrites, axons, and there's already information there for the biologists together. So this you can do. And now in the middle you have the glia, which is kind of the, I'm actually not sure what they do. They kind of provide stability for the rest of the neurons. And then you have the myelinated axons. Those were those guys with the thick black borders, right? Things like that. So this is our goal. This is what we want to do now automatically. And this is our pipeline to do it. So this is in the version of the pipeline as it was. And we actually extended it now to the alignment before. Because before we had an alignment that worked. And now with the bigger data sets, we actually needed to go back and solve the alignment problem. So now we're starting with already aligned images. And we want that segmentation. So the first thing to realize is every cell, doesn't matter if it's a dendrite part, axon, soma, whatever, is surrounded by a membrane. So it makes sense to look for the membranes in those images. So our first step is a classifier that spits out a probability map for each pixel, whether it's a membrane or not. And I already said, the field of computer vision got really, really boring. It's a convolutional neural network that does this nowadays. And then you get these probability maps. And you need to group them to really, you need to still transform that into a 3D segmentation of your 3D object, right? At the moment, those are two different steps. We're actually doing the probability maps in 2D, because then that network can already run while the alignment runs. Okay, I can already do membrane probabilities on the images if it's 2D before they are aligned. So this is why at the moment it's still 2D, but
But then, of course, to find the 3D objects, I need the aligned images. And then you can have the three-dimensional reconstruction for proofreading. So now we come to Felix's work. So convolutional networks, as any classifier in deep learning, are very hungry for training data. Now the problem is, with natural images now, there are gigantic databases, right? I actually think at some point Berkeley, Malik is the guy who built that database. I think he actually forced each of his students to annotate 5 images or they wouldn't get their final grade, okay? So this is how computer vision people typically build their databases. The problem is we can't do that because those electron microscopy images took me a while to actually see all the structures in them. I still, after years and years of staring at these, can't reliably detect synapses. Not as good as someone who has stared at those professionally nearly all their life. So Felix built this tool for interactive annotations. And the idea is, when you annotate those images blindly, if I just give 100 images to the biologist and say, please annotate, Daniel, most probably, has to sit down and draw in each image, okay? And he, the full image, go to the next, go to the next, go to the next. Tedious, boring work. So, but it turns out 80% of those pixels are actually very easy to annotate. Like, you still need to draw it. But they're very easy to learn for the classifier because they're very clear membranes. And then there are other cases that are very hard. So after only a few iterations of training, the classifier already gets all those easy things right, which means all the additional annotations that were provided actually weren't that useful and cost Daniel a lot of his time. So instead, this tool allows you to annotate. Here, it's actually a bit hard to see, but you can annotate a couple of membranes and a couple of not membrane. You can actually have more classes. You could also say, this is a mitochondria, and it's going to be blue, and these are vesicles, and they're going to be yellow. And you can see this actually runs in your browser, so it's working distributed. And in the background, there's a server with the GPU training the convolutional network constantly. You're providing annotations. You get immediate feedback from the classifier, and it is in its training status right now. So it's going to update this overlay here. And then the human can identify mistakes and, I don't know, say, here are these little fingers out here. These actually should have been red. These membranes need to be smaller. This guy here most probably is not a membrane. So you only provide the labels for the parts where the classifier is still struggling. And that makes annotation a lot faster and easier. And because it's in a browser, you can actually also have multiple people annotating at the same time. They get the feedback from the same network. And Felix tweaked the training algorithm to pay more attention to the data that is coming in right now. Okay, so if you provide new samples, these are the ones that the classifier is going to pay attention to first now, because you just provided that feedback based on the training status it had. But because it's a deep classifier, training those guys is typically very time consuming. So after you provided a sufficient amount of training data, it actually can be beneficial also to go for a coffee, come back, and your images look better. But it's going to keep training and training in the background. And he actually showed, oh, so this is the architecture where you have the server in the background constantly crunching, and it's all connected. But he showed that this is not only more fun, can actually give you better results. So in red here, blue is the baseline if you wouldn't use machine learning. In red is the offline trained network that actually used all the images, and like Daniel annotating every pixel. And the other guy here actually got better. And the reason, I believe, we have to look a bit more into this, but this is not new. This is a result that was also gathered for random forests. So this type of interactive interface has been also done for random forest classifiers, and it had the same result. And I think the reason is that otherwise the classifier is spending so much time, so much effort to get all the easy cases right, right, that it can't pay that much attention to the other ones. The other big thing to realize is we actually cannot train on what we really want, because there are different types of mistakes. This is a merge error, which means these should have been two regions, but there's a gap in between, and it's actually one. So this is a missing, these few pixels, is a big, big, big mistake in my segmentation. But every classifier out there typically is trained on pixel classification error, right? Which means, especially for the other side, it's more important, if that actually should have been one region, and the classifier did this, that's big, right? That's a split error. But on the other hand, if it would have done this, I couldn't care less. I can just filter those out. But for the classifier, the metric the classifier is training with, that is the same amount of mistakes, right? Because these were pixels that are not membrane, that are classified as membrane, right? It's the same way the other way around. It doesn't have this concept of full regions being split or merged. So what the human does now by providing annotation, it's biasing the classifier to pay more attention to these guys, because most humans are not bothering, at least not in the beginning, to correct these guys, because they know these can be filtered. What they are going to correct are the split errors and the merge errors. So you're tuning your classifier to really do what you want it to do. So I already said this is the typical CNN architecture. And we're actually having special intentions to making the prediction fast. That's something people typically don't care about. So one idea is to use dynamic programming. So convolutional neural networks have convolutional filters. And I already said, typically you have one patch. Actually, can't reach all the way up, I think. You have one patch, and you just want to predict the middle pixel. So these filters go over this little patch. There's nothing preventing you from having that filter run over the whole image. That's much more efficient. If I classify one patch for the middle pixel, I want to do the next pixel, I'm moving that big patch by one pixel and repeating the whole computation. That's super wasteful. So instead, I could do the whole image. The problem are the max pooling layers. So typically, convolutional neural networks have a convolutional layer, and then a pooling layer, which means you look at a 2x2 neighborhood, and you take out the maximum. So now I need to keep track of where that maximum was. So the idea is dynamic programming. In that patch, the maximum could have been in the upper left corner, in the upper right, right? Four different positions. So instead of throwing those away and actually doing the max pooling, I'm applying the filter to the whole image, and then I keep track of the values in these four corners by building four fragments. So this is the fragment with all the values of the upper left corners. Okay? This I can then convolve again. And so in the next iteration, I have 16 patches. And this can run over a whole image, and you can see it gave a decent speed up from 3 minutes down to 50 seconds. But then development went further on. I'm actually going to skip that part. And in 2015, at ICCV, Microsoft came and said, haha, you all think you're doing deep learning with your 6 layers, 10 layers. Google was super crazy and did 22. Guys, we have 125. And they actually had slides where these networks were going and going and going and going. And their trick is, so typically these networks would be impossible to train. They show that. If you do naive gradient backpropagation, no way. What they do instead is they have these guys here. They have little highways. So these are typical convolutional layers. These little arrows are what everybody else is doing. These things here is what Microsoft put on top. So they have these highways that skip a few layers and then put their input there again, there again. So when I train them backwards, the signal can also travel along these paths and skip layers. And they showed that with that, they could beat the state of the art on natural images and actually train 125 layers. So this is what we're currently looking into. For us, the big benefit also is they don't use pooling layers anymore. somehow when you make them that deep, you don't need them anymore, which means even a fairly large network can run at least 2 megapixels per second. That's nice. I only need 100 GPUs to keep up with my microscope. So we have the main part. I'm not going to talk much about the region grouping because we're just using a library there. It's a random forest that just judges whether two segments should be merged together, and then you do agglomerative clustering according to the score. And we come to nice videos. So this is flying through a segmented stack here, and you can actually track neurons of one color through. And here now are 3D reconstructions before proofreading. So these are bigger structures that have been found. And you can already see from what I said before, this is not a cubic millimeter, right? You can see the cell bodies in there. So it's still in the 100 micron something range. But we're getting there. And here's my problem with the spines. Actually, if anybody's interested in working with me on that, I could use someone. we do get the big guys fairly good, fairly well. And then all these little spines are also fairly well segmented, but they're not glued onto that spine. Because that random forest that learns whether two things should belong together has a hard time learning that such a big guy should be orthogonal, right, connected to such a small guy. And I'm going to, so this is our proofreading tool that Daniel built, and that's it. If you're interested, all our source code is online, actually like that. We're a totally transparent group, so you can find everything that I just presented on our GitHub directory. And that is, in general, the homepage of the pipeline, also with a paper that is a bit more the previous version where there was still a random forest doing the membrane probability predictions. But if you're interested in reading more, also, of course, talk to me. That's it. Nearly. Yeah, I know. Yeah, that confused me. I tried,
so
but
have,
yeah.
4 or 5 minutes. Sure.
Yeah.
The problem of merge and split errors, is there any possibility of actually putting the topology into the loss function that you're
yes,
using?
I really, really want to. There's actually one guy who did, Srini Turaga. He built a cost function based on the RAND index. And the RAND index was used in clustering to see how regions overlap. And I stayed a bit away from his stuff because it didn't work in the past. Like he had, the paper is from 2010. But it's really hard because, in principle, it's a global thing, right? It's a more global thing to train on. So yes, people are trying. And now it's actually starting with the big data sets that we now have to train and the GPU speed behind it that they're starting to work. So yes, it's actually on my list to look into now again. But about 3 years ago when it came out, the results weren't that convincing yet. But now he actually, just recently there was a Connectomics meeting and he showed results where I was like, now I'm going to look into this. So yeah, people have been trying and now finally also successfully. Yeah.
One more question.
Yes?
It's a very naive question, Matt. If an electron microscope is not fine enough to detect these details, how are you able to physically slice that thing without destroying those details?
So I'm looking, so the electron microscope is, right, the light microscope was the one who couldn't resolve.
The light microscope is not fine enough, doesn't have quite enough detail, and yet you're able to slice, physically slice pieces of tissue fine enough to not destroy those details.
Yes, because the light microscope is the fraction of light, right? When you have your light wave, that's 200 nanometers. So when you cut a 30 nanometer section, your section thickness is better than a light microscope could even image. That's completely true. Those 30 nanometers, though, they do have a catch with those spine necks. And it's one other of the reasons that we can't get them that well. if you have sections, right, and your structure is like super thin, and then even running like that, and a bit wiggly on top, then you might lose it, right? Or if you have something that is running, not sure if I can draw this now, you might accidentally do this, right? Because it's really hard, that is true. But our smallest structures are these spinecs. Those can go down, like in the worst case, they're about 25 nanometers. So it's still in the range. But they're trying to cut thinner, but at some point, right, there's only so much resin can give you instability. But maybe they come up with an ingenious, great new idea. There are microscopes that mill using ions. Like they're also destroying the sample. It's called FIB, focused ion beam milling. They have the sample and they literally shoot away one layer. They can shoot away 5 nanometers. Beautiful volumes, isotropic. You don't even know how it's rotated, no alignment problem, but unfortunately, no way to image a cubic millimeter even with that microscope. The field of view is too small and the speed is too slow.
All right.
Thank you.
Happy to talk more.
Everybody.
Yes.